Stop sharing. Good morning, everyone. My name is Chris Swan, and I am Dean of Undergraduate Education in the Tufts School of Engineering and Associate Professor in the Department of Civil and Environmental Engineering and in Tisch College for Civic Life. I'd like to welcome all of you to the Tufts School of Engineering's 9th lecture in the Dean's Lecture Series and the first of the school's colloquium series on diversity, equity, and inclusion in STEM. You should know that this session will be recorded and posted to view later for those who are not able to join us live this morning. We are also offering closed captioning and will be included both during the live session and in the recording. Each year, the School of Engineering welcomes exceptional guest speakers to Tufts to deliver lectures that enlighten, inform, and educate the community on the latest trends within the engineering, business, and education areas. This year, due to the pandemic that has swept through our country and around the globe, we are holding our first virtual Dean's Lecture. Our lecture series speakers are renowned leaders in their fields. They include inventors, entrepreneurs, vice presidents, CEOs, and now college presidents. Their talks have covered a wide range of topics from engineering education to 3D printing, revolutions to manufacturing ventures that focus on high volume human organ regeneration, as well as other relevant topics to our discipline. Today's speaker is no different. Additionally, we are happy to inaugurate the School of Engineering Colloquium on Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion in STEM. The goal of the colloquium is to highlight exemplary DEI efforts by individuals in engineering, as well as other STEM fields. Again, the speaker's DEI accomplishments are impressive, and the topic on which she will present has never been more important. We are honored today to have Dr. Anthony Monaco, president of Tufts University, to introduce our speaker. So President Monaco, the Zoom floor is now yours.
Well, thank you, Chris, and good morning, everyone, and welcome to the Fall 2020 Tufts School of Engineering Dean's Lecture and the first installment in our exciting new colloquium series on diversity, equity, and inclusion in STEM. I'd like to thank you for attending this year's virtual lecture, and I would especially like to thank our speaker and my esteemed colleague, Dr. Gilda Barabino, president of Olin College of Engineering and professor of biomedical and chemical engineering, for joining us today. Thank you, Dr. Barabino. In July, Dr. Gilda Barabino became the second president of Olin College of Engineering. A biomedical engineer trained in chemical engineering with broad interest in global health systems and interdisciplinary engineering education, Dr. Barabino is a noted investigator in the areas of sickle cell disease and cellular and tissue engineering. She is an internationally recognized thought leader and highly sought speaker and consultant on race, ethnicity, and gender in science and engineering, with particular focus on creating cultures and climates that support a sense of belonging. President Barabino has led a number of initiatives in these areas, including serving as the founder and executive director of the National Institute for Faculty Equity. She is an active member of the National Academy of Engineering and the National Academy of Medicine. Her exceptional honors include the American Institute of Chemical Engineering Award for Service to Society, the Presidential Award for Excellence in Science, Mathematics, and Engineering Mentoring, and the Pierre Galletti Award, the highest honor awarded by the American Institute for Medical and Biological Engineering. As Dean Swan aptly pointed out, this series is meant to enlighten and educate our community on pressing issues within the engineering community. In a year of pressing issues, few have struck us as urgently as the need for greater diversity, equity, and inclusion in all industries and aspects of our society. Not only does the conversation regarding systemic racism in the United States need to continue, but we also need to put proactive anti-racist action in place so that we might make a positive and lasting contribution toward ending racism in our communities. President Barabino is here to offer her input and insights on the importance of diversifying STEM fields. Please welcome the president of Olin College, Dr. Gilda Barabino.
Okay. So introductions are now done. Our discussion now will happen between Gilda and myself to basically provide a sort of a full introduction to her and her work, as well as in other aspects of higher education. So Gilda, welcome.
Thank you, Chris. And I'd like to thank the president for that kind introduction.
Thank you. So I have a series of introductory questions, basically looking at your history, if you will, in this field. So could you elaborate, what is your background prior to even going to college? And how did that influence your direction of pursuing a degree as you did and moving forward with your academic career?
Sure. I'll try to give you the short version, but answering a question like that gives me the opportunity to reflect on those experiences. And I have to say, it started early on. I was raised in a military family. I was born in Anchorage, Alaska, and we moved around the country. We even did a stint in Germany at one time. And I would say one thing that was always consistent that my parents instilled upon me and my siblings, a real sense of the importance of education. We also learned early on the importance of understanding and respecting different cultures in different environments. And I became very able and capable at adapting and moving to different places and learning what's new. So that was one thing that really was important in those formative experiences and getting started.
Excellent. So you went through, and as the president has highlighted, you went through and did college as a chemistry major in your undergrad, and then moved into chemical engineering and biomedical engineering. I want to know what caused that transition from chemistry into engineering?
Sure. So interestingly, one of the reasons why I even looked at chemistry in the first place is when I was a junior in high school, at a college prep high school, the chemistry teacher gave the impression that girls weren't well suited for chemistry. So I was in a pre-college program where I took chemistry at the college level while I was a senior in high school. And that actually started me on this path of chemistry as a major. I was at Xavier University of Louisiana in New Orleans, which is known for its placing African-Americans in particular in medical profession, in the medical profession, producing physicians. And I started out as a chemistry pre-med major, but early on realized that my clinician route might not have been the right route for me. Squeamish, faint at the sight of blood. So I was looking for a way to still have a career that had implications for medicine. And I thought engineering and applying engineering principles to medical problems was the pathway. That's what brought me to chemical engineering in particular. And I did think about biomedical engineering, but at the time, biomedical engineering had not come into its own the way it has now. And there were not many biomedical engineering programs across the country. So chemical engineering was actually my path towards engineering career and applying engineering to medicine.
Okay. So you completed your doctorate work at Rice and proceeded into academia, but your study area was sickle cell disease. Could you explain what made you do that and basically what your work is within that area?
Sure. So like many students from underrepresented groups, part of my career driver was to have a discipline and have a career path that could impact my community. So I chose sickle cell disease for my thesis research. Sickle cell disease disproportionately affects African-Americans. And I thought that if I could apply engineering in a way that it could actually be useful for coming up with treatments for sickle cell disease. That was an important way for me to give back to the community. That's how I got started in sickle cell research, which I have continued to this day.
So with that statement, it makes me think about how representation, or maybe even the lack thereof, of unrepresented and even gender, in your case, especially for engineering, how that motivated you. Could you talk a little bit about how that was a motivating factor for you and to pursue the career that you have?
So to give you a little context, when I started the graduate program in chemical engineering at Rice, I was the first African-American, male or female, to be admitted to that graduate program. Mm-hmm. And that year that I was admitted was only 15 years after Rice had admitted its first African-American undergraduate and graduate students. Mm-hmm. So in that context of being first and only, that actually did impact my career path and the way that I thought about it. When I entered the academy at Northeastern in 89 in chemical engineering, I was the first African-American female to hold a tenure track position in chemical engineering in the nation. So again, being one of a few, it actually does impact your career and your career choices, because this isolation, marginalization, you're operating in a system where they're not really used to people who look like you in that system. And so how do you navigate that system? And that's something that's been important to me in terms of thinking about what I've learned from that experience that I could share with others to make sure that others could learn from that, and that we would provide opportunities, particularly so that others didn't have to go through the same kinds of things that I went through. That was part of my motivation.
Good, because now my question was going to actually be the difficulties that you did experience. What things did you know, did you notice, if you will, in pursuing this career path that you have done? And how did you overcome those challenges that came to you?
So I noticed several things. In our disciplines, our systems, it's not just about the technology, it's about the people. It's like who's there, who's entering, who's practicing, and who's not practicing. Who are the gatekeepers, and who's encouraging or not encouraging? Mm-hmm. I learned the importance of socialization. Like, how do you actually become a member of the profession? Learn the spoken and unspoken rules, learn the technology, but also how to use it, and to use it in a way that you're actually part of the profession as a practitioner. And so what I understood was there are ways to move forward, whether you're isolated or not. There's ways to have support networks. As you can imagine, we know that's important to have role models and mentors. From what I just explained to you, you can imagine I didn't have any. Mm-hmm. There weren't people who looked like me to help guide. But there are other ways to connect and to stay focused on what it is we are trying to accomplish. So those were some of the things that I thought were really important as I was going forward. How to create the support that was needed, stay focused on the work that needed to be done, and achieve excellence in carrying it out. Because there's one thing that we know, there's a body of work that we need to do. Our work can speak for itself and be that record that you would then base your next career advancements on.
Mm-hmm. So you made the decision after college to pursue an academic direction. Could you quickly just briefly talk about how you progressed through that process to actually making it to being president at Olin?
Sure. Mm-hmm. I think an important thing when I reflect back and like what got me into the track that would even lead me to a presidency, throughout my experience as a faculty member, I talked about the socialization piece of it. I was thinking, okay, how do I better understand these pathways so that I can navigate them? I actually turned to the social sciences and started learning more about organizational dynamics, behaviors. And I actually would apply things that I learned in the social science literature to help me navigate. And in doing that, I realized it wasn't just me. There were others who would have the same kinds of issues. And then how do we come together, learn from that, again, learnings from the social sciences, and apply that to progressing in these technical fields? So one of the reasons why I entered into an administrative path in the first place is to have a broader impact. Because one of the things that I learned, you have to have a seat at the table. You have to be part of the decision-making. You have to know where the decisions are being made, and we need diverse perspectives where those decisions are being made. So my first administrative role actually was at Northeastern University as a vice provost for undergraduate education. That helped me understand the dynamics within the institution. It helped me understand higher education. It helped me understand more like, what are the blocks? Where are the blocks that are gatekeeping blocks? And how do we use policies and practices in a way that they're more inclusive? How do we get perspectives at the table that are diverse and have that input into where the decisions are being made? That kind of understanding of being in the room and having a seat at the table actually kept me in academic administration as a way forward to make a difference.
Yeah, I mean, I could see that your difference was really in on being impactful to what students were seeing.
Exactly.
Not just on your own career, but also what students are doing. So you were at Northeastern, and you ended up being the dean at a rather nice university in New York City. Right. How was that experience different than what you were experiencing at Northeastern?
Well, you know, context matters, environments matter, types of institutions matter. Whether it's teaching intensive or research intensive, missions of an institution makes a difference. And I'll say one of the things that drew me to the City College of New York as a dean was because there was an institutional mission of access to excellence. There was a history. When the institution was founded in 1847, it was founded on granting access to students of all backgrounds, regardless of race, ethnicity, or economic backgrounds. So you might have picked up this theme in my career. It's like diversity, equity, inclusion has been very important to me. So part of why I left Georgia Tech to go to a place like that as dean was, again, around how can you have impact and impacting the careers of the young people, particularly those who may not have had the same opportunities as others. So that was my driver. And while that institution may not have been as well resourced as the institution that I left, what was important is the human capacity and what we can do with building that human capacity. So the leaders, the faculty who choose to work in those environments to build the next generation, that was really important. And I felt like I was able to have some impact in that setting as well.
I agree. So here you are, dean at a nice institution, very nice institution, and now you are president at Olin. Could you talk about that transition, moving from being thinking as a dean and saying, now I'm going to go to Olin? What was that process that you went through?
Sure. So in my view, what this allowed me is to operate on a bigger platform and in a way that you can make a difference. Leaders do make a difference. And so you can have an influence at one level as a faculty member, as a department chair, as a dean, as a provost, but there's no substitute for president. And so I believe that the experiences that I had all along were actually formative and just transferable, just the right thing, the right alignment of professional goals and the mission of the institution. That alignment and the previous experiences that I had were just right for Olin. And I'll tell you what's really exciting for me about my match with a place like Olin. Olin started roughly 20 years ago, and the mandate was to transform engineering education, to have constant change and innovation, to tie in entrepreneurship, with liberal arts and engineering, train the whole engineer, to have students centered at the center of the education and look at students as co-creators with faculty. So co-creating the learning environment. So with that, and also the institutional mission towards social justice, that combination and looking for a new leader to lead an institution who's ready now to go from the 20-year point to the next level, I could not have found a better fit. So that really excites me, of that type of alignment and the ability to do it in this situation where change, innovation, and how do we do things differently to continue to be transformative.
Thank you. Yes, I completely agree. You have an opportunity here to actually transform an institution, but also transform a lot of what happens in engineering education. So I wanted to get back to a question regarding Olin and its DEI efforts. It is a college of engineering. So now you're talking about bringing DEI within engineering. What are some of the things that Olin is doing with regards to that in the curricular and co-curricular, extracurricular? What are the things that Olin is doing?
So you'll hear from me, and this is part of what's important at Olin, the importance of having inclusive environments for success, and having environments that actually support the individuals, meet them where they are, and bring them into the community of practitioners and have a sense of belonging. So that's one piece of it. So another piece of it is, how do you match up the desires that people have of wanting to make a difference in the world and the educational experience that they can have? So the literature actually shows us that women and underrepresented minorities in particular are drawn to fields where they can have, through that discipline, a profession that allows them to have societal impact. So when you create your curriculum, when you create your learning environment and what students study and how they study it, in ways that they can have real world experiences in a team setting with design, with the idea that what they're working on is actually going to have some societal impact, that has strong diversity, equity, and inclusion implications. Olin started with a mandate as part of their precepts that there would be gender equity. So from the beginning, there's always been roughly 50% women in every class. So Olin does have a real track record now and some history that they can look at. The influence of having women on these teams in this curricular setting over a number of years. And you actually can see the difference of teams that are diverse versus teams that aren't. And we know that diverse teams come up with better solutions. We know we need the diverse perspectives. So that model, that approach, that philosophy, those values is what drives our diversity, equity, and inclusion. And I think that's been very important because those are ways to attract and retain those from underrepresented groups, both students and faculty. So that's the overall approach.
Does Olin do any civic engagement efforts with the community, Needham, Wellesley area?
We do. So the students have been very engaged, faculty as well, and projects that impact the community. Very engaged with members of the community. For example, the Needham public school systems has been a partner with Olin. Yeah. Students from Olin have done projects and worked with people inside the public school system. Yeah. Thinking about projects that might have some impact on the environment in Needham and beyond. So having students have that, make that connection between their community and feel some responsibility for the community that they reside in. And also to think about that more broadly. So our students are often looking for ways to serve, not just in the Needham area, but beyond.
Interesting. So let's get to the thing that has been dominating our lives for the last few months, and that's COVID-19. How has that impacted not the DEI, that's something, but also the traditional operations at Olin, both of those areas. How has COVID-19 impacted what Olin is trying to do?
So if you can imagine, we just talked about this hands-on, and we also have, we're small. So our faculty student ratio is fantastic. We have like 8 students per faculty. We are very much about design and working in teams. A virtual environment makes that very difficult. And how do you capture the essence of that in a virtual environment? So I talked about we're very much into innovation and constant change. So like, well, you have to be pretty innovative and very creative if you're thinking about how do you capture that in-person, hands-on kind of feeling and way of operating in a virtual environment. And so our faculty and our students have worked together, and the faculty worked really hard to come up with kits, design kits that they could use for the different courses. They've sent design kits all over the world because we do have some international students. They've also thought about how do you capture the essence of the quality of the interaction between the faculty member and the student in a virtual environment. And they've done some unique things around trying to stay connected even though they're virtual. So COVID has actually pushed us to think much harder about the educational experience, how you capture it. And it, we've also seen the importance of those interactions. And because I do look at everything through a diversity, equity, and inclusion lens, I will say that it is not just structural diversity of like representation and having different people from different backgrounds represented. It's also the interactional diversity. And that means like, how are you interacting and the quality of those interactions across race, across gender, you know, other dimensions, and how do you capture that in a way that it's rich and meaningful in the learning environment, even when you're virtual?
Interesting. So let's move to the future.
Sure.
About Olin, but also about STEM education. So what can you tell me what excites you about the future of STEM and STEM education?
Sure, absolutely. And I must say that the COVID has played a role in this too, like, because COVID has so disproportionately impacted Black and Brown communities, and COVID has so shone a light on disparities in the country, be it around health, wealth, or education. That's something that's really stood out. So thinking about the future of STEM education and STEM research, we know that we need to do a better job around eliminating inequities. And I think that inequalities globally is one of our biggest threats. And in fact, Pew did a study a while back where they, it was a global study where they asked people to talk about and rank what they saw as the biggest threats around the world. And a very high percentage of people across different nations, in the US included, ranked inequality as one of the biggest threats. So here's why I'm so excited about STEM education and STEM research. We can actually use STEM education and research as an enabler, as a tool to stem those inequalities across the board. What's also really exciting is that the young people right now, they are very well attuned to these issues of social justice and what can they do about it. They are very well attuned to wanting careers like STEM, where they can have these a career that where the science technology background is an enabler for them to do good in the world. And they're vocal about it, like they're ready for it. We know that the youth, the younger people, the fresh ideas, it's what's really gonna move us forward. That is the most exciting thing to me. This combination, this confluence of, here's where we need to pay our attention. We have disciplines that can make a difference. Connect that with this goal of social justice, making the world a more just and humane place. And you've got this cadre of young people who are saying, I want it now. And they're pushing us to do more of it. And we're aligning their career goals and aspirations with fields that are STEM fields.
I can tell that you're passionate about this. It definitely comes across. So I want to know, if you could explain, what is driving your push for DEI and J, the justice part in STEM? What do you feel is the driver for you, sure. your person, your own inner feeling, not just what the people are saying in the literature and stuff, but what is your driver for that?
So my personal driver has always been equity. Like, how do we make the world a more equitable place? That's always been my personal driver. Mm-hmm. And I've chosen career-wise to do that through engineering education and research. And I strongly believe that if we really want the world to be a better place, we would eliminate those barriers. We would make things such that the inequities that exist both systemically and behaviorally that contribute to these gaps in health, in wealth, in education, these gaps that keep us from having a healthy society. And that's both for people and the environment. Those are drivers that I think have always been with me. And I really feel strongly about that. And I also feel like it's important for us to take leadership roles and use them in ways that we can affect change. So the time is now. I mentioned this confluence of what's going on with the country actually being more awakened. And there's a reckoning now around what do we do around racial justice? There's a reckoning around what do we do around science and engineering and having truth in science and engineering? There's a reckoning around what do we do to provide more opportunities, because it's the opportunity gap that makes the biggest difference. So that's another thing that drives me. Like, if we could make sure that all who want to and have the aptitude for our fields actually have the opportunity not only to enter, but to remain and thrive in these fields so they're positioned to make a difference in the world, that's a driver that'll go for quite a bit of time.
Yes. Never run out of fuel on that one. What I wanted to do, make this known, we ask people to actually send in questions, so we're going to be asking some of those questions. But for those who are now participating, we do have a Q&A button that people can actually click on and actually insert questions that we can actually explore during this presentation. But let me ask you this question that someone sent in prior to the presentation. What factors historically contributed and in some cases continue to contribute to the challenges that BIPOC face in STEM education?
Well, there's quite a number of challenges, but I will try to highlight a few.
Okay.
So one thing top on the list is we have ingrained policies and practices that make it advantageous for some and disadvantageous for others. So systemic problems that are in our educational systems that serve as gatekeepers, that let some in and don't let others in. We have a dearth of faculty role models and mentors from underrepresented groups. So until our faculty and role models and mentors start to reflect the population, we're gonna continue to have those kinds of problems. We have environments, I stress the environments. We have environments that can be unwelcoming and unsupportive for people who are from non-traditional backgrounds or backgrounds that are typically marginalized or unrepresented. We also have a problem with just trying to make visible the invisible. And some of the things that are invisible that I think is a problem that serves as gatekeeping, it's not just these systemic structural problems. We also have behaviors and attitudes. We have things like, just think about it, someone telling a young student just because of the way they look, you know what? I don't think you should ever think about science. Think about something else. Those kinds of comments have such a lasting impact, particularly if they're coming from a recognized person, a person in authority, like a faculty member or a teacher, to a young, impressionable person. Many of them internalize that and say, oh, I guess I'm going to have to go do something else. So we have factors like that. And ultimately, what people want is a sense of belonging. And if we create environments that tell people, you know what, you don't belong here, that's going to be a problem. So we can work on that. It is not about just fix the individual, because that's a deficit way of thinking. These individuals are fine. We pushed them out. So why don't we have environments that can be more inclusive? And sometimes I think it's like a failure to even recognize and admit and call it out for what it is. So the longer that we go where we try to say, no, it was something else rather than what it actually is. If we don't name what the problems are and make them visible and do something towards it, we'll continue to have these obstacles. But the good news is we can name them and we can do something about it.
Yeah. Thank you. Another question someone submitted beforehand. How can students, as well as others without a lot of institutional power, make their institutions more equitable?
Sure. So students have more power than they think. I think students can use their collective voice to speak out for what they need and what they want. Students can speak out for lots of things and create demand. For example, if students are saying, you know, I want a curriculum that is more inclusive, I want to learn about racism, they can push and get some responses to that from both faculty and administrators. And in fact, if you look at history, there have been student movements throughout time where students rose up collectively, voiced their concerns and effective change on their institutional campuses. So I think there's a lot that students can do. Students can hold people accountable. Students can lead by example. And often students are drivers because they might walk the talk and practice what we preach. They're actually practicing it and pushing us to practice as well. Mm-hmm. So I do think that there's a lot of power that students have. They can organize themselves. They can make themselves heard. And I believe absolutely there can be responses to students and what they are looking for.
Awesome. So take this question that just came up on the question and answer. So please, everyone, continue to provide those questions. Who or what was your, would you identify as your greatest source of inspiration?
Huh.
And so, you can have sources. I mean.
Great. I will have sources. So one internal driver, another parents who instilled this sense of responsibility in education. Another tremendous source for me, my husband and my son. Mm-hmm. Because no matter what, at the end of the day, my husband and my son have been my biggest advocates, biggest supporters, and confidants, helped me understand. I can remember times where I would say, I don't know if I can continue doing this. They would not hear it at all. That source of support is really important. And I think we need to get support where we can find it. And many of us have different ways of where we draw our support. But those have always, what I just described has been what's fueled me. And also this idea of like really making a difference. I, like others, I want to have something to show for my time here. Mm-hmm. And that has actually driven the choices that I've made. Is I'm going to do that because I really want to make a difference. So those are multiple ways that I've found support throughout my career.
Okay. Thank you for that response. I really, really appreciate it. Another question that came on the Q&A card. Someone is curious if you have thoughts on this recent article in Nature Communications that concludes that female mentor-mentee pairs in academia are less successful, and therefore opposite gender mentorship may actually increase the impact of women who pursue a scientific career. That was the statement.
Okay, let's unpack that.
So I'll give you 15 minutes, you can go.
There's a context to everything, and a certain context, that statement might be true. In another context, it's not. I actually think we need multiple mentors, multiple role models. We need multiple settings, and the context absolutely does matter. I think there's a role, and a very important role, that same gender, same race mentoring plays, as well as cross gender and cross race mentoring. It's not an either or. You can have all of that and have success. The one thing that same race, same gender mentoring does, that there is something about that shared experience that there's no substitute for. And it does make a difference. Now, the reason why sometimes that might seem less impactful, it's not those individuals or that relationship. It's those outside things that I was talking about, those structural things, those policies and practices, perceptions, it's the outside world. So if you have an outside world, policies and practices and systems that weren't set up for those same race, same gender people, what happens is their perceptions that hold back, their policies and practices, their attitudes, their stereotypes, that's what's making it a less successful relationship, not the quality of the relationship. So if someone says, perceives, and then passes it on, like, well, I don't think this minority woman has the same connections as someone else, so don't use them as a mentor. You know, it's that kind of thing that happens that can impact the quality or the ability of these relationships to have as much impact as they could possibly have. But it's taking that all in context that makes a difference.
Yeah, thank you for that. That really makes it interesting. Here's another question that's come in through the gates here. Are there particular examples of actions, for example, policy changes and so forth, at Olin to address inequities, or policy changes you like to have happen? So what are your thoughts on that?
Yeah, you know, so I have thought a lot about policies and practices. And I think about policies and practices at the institutional level, at local government levels, and national policies and practices. And what I've found a lot is it's not necessarily that we have the wrong policies and practices in place, it's how we apply them. And if I was gonna push for something right now, I would push for the way we apply our policies and practices, that we are intentional and that we are holding ourselves accountable to say, are we actually doing that in an equitable way? I think leaders can take it upon themselves to be proactive. You don't have to wait for someone to come in with a complaint. You can take that look yourself across your institution and say, salaries, for example, how we reward and recognize, are we doing that equitably? Does it look like it's skewed one way or the other? I think that's really important, because nowadays it's not within the institutions, you don't usually see where someone's going to put in place a policy or a practice that's blatantly against one group or another. That's not what usually happens. What usually happens is how we apply it. How do we do evaluations? How do we say what it is, what criteria by which we are evaluating on? How do we communicate that? I would put more emphasis on how to do that equitably. So for me as a leader at Olin, I would take that proactive stance. I would look at what we were doing and how we are applying it across the board to everyone and do it proactively.
Okay, it's not just the policy, it's how it's applied. I agree.
Yes.
Sounds great. In that vein, let me move from academia to another position. What steps should companies take in their hiring practices to increase the number of diverse STEM candidates?
Sure, absolutely. I think that there's some things that I've seen that companies do in their recruitment, where they recruit. and the criteria by which they're using to determine whether or not they want to bring something in, bring someone in. So oftentimes companies are only recruiting at certain places, and they're recruiting where they, where, you know, they might be top ranked institutions. Mm-hmm. They're missing whole groups of people if they don't recruit more broadly. So some of it is just broadening the pool of where you're recruiting, looking at the criteria. Do we really think that a grade point average at an arbitrary level really is going to say who's going to succeed or not? So sometimes it's like broadening how we assess talent and what looks like the talent that's going to be right for that company. I think companies would do well to partner more with academic institutions to create those feeder situations, those pipelines into the companies, and have a better, and industry and academics have a better sense of what industry is looking for and how academics is training those for those industrial needs. So a better alignment of the needs and how people are trained. So one of the biggest issues really is where we're looking, the criteria we apply, who's applying the criteria, and are we really making sure that we're doing it in a way that's devoid of biases and stereotypes? That combination together really could help industry do a better job of broadening their base.
Okay, I have just a few more questions. I'm trying to get as many as I can. And one was, how was your and your family's experience being Black in a military lifestyle?
So the military, just like anywhere else, is just a microcosm of society. Mm-hmm. And so we felt the same kinds of strains of being one of a few in the military environments as well. And in the military, you also have the rank structure with that as well. So there's the officer ranks and there's the enlisted ranks. My father was enlisted. He was what was called a non-commissioned officer for enlisted. So here's some things I learned early on in my growing up in military bases. There was housing that was segregated if you were an officer or a non-commissioned officer. But yet when we were in the classrooms on the military schools, we're all mixed up. But you can, when you leave school, you're going off to your different environments. Like I remember asking my parents, what's that about? Like, why are we doing that? And there's rules around fraternization. So the officers weren't supposed to fraternize with the non-commissioned officers. So they enlisted socially. I'm like, what's that about? Like, so you could see it. So then you've got that, you layer race on that. And I remember my father in particular having limited opportunities as a Black man in the military. So even though he scored really high on some of the exams, he was relegated to certain areas to work regardless of his scores. That was all about race. And we talked about race at home all the time. And so, and as it would play out, even in the military, benefits, like just everything, how they're applied. So we understood that the military was not an escape for the racial dynamics that happen in the country. But we also did see what happens when you do have cases where the military did step up a bit, because there was integration in the military even when it wasn't in other areas. So we got to see this dichotomy almost, and it was part of the learning experience.
Another question. Olin and Tufts are singularly unique and special institutions. Okay. How do we restore the confidence and support in our public institutions of higher education and the importance and reach of them to improving diversity, equity, and inclusion?
So I think it's important, regardless of what type of institution we are in, to look at our common shared goals and values of what we're trying to do and how we're trying to impact and influence the world. If we did more about partnering on complementary areas and sharing resources. So there are things that might be in one institution, in one context, in one setting, that it seems like it's more resourced than another in one area, but there might be another area in a less resourced area, which maybe they're more diverse, but there are ways that we could build on each other's strengths. We can build on the complementarity. We can build on that shared goal and vision for moving forward. Come up with ways that are better for higher education in general, and that can help. We should use whatever we have as our voice, whatever privileged standing we have, use it in service of others to amplify voices, to amplify impact. That sharing around these goals and objectives that we all have in common will really be a way forward for all of us.
Thank you for that. So let me ask my final question. On what and how can Tufts and Olin collaborate to build a more inclusive and equitable STEM community? I'm already writing the proposal, so you just let me know.
Absolutely. Well, so I think areas that we have common goals and objectives and strengths, we focus on the environments for students and to have a close environment for faculty and students to work together. And that's important. That's a strength. And how do we use that together? Why don't we have cross-institutional projects that we work on that's thematic, but we're bringing teams together across our institutions, building on those strengths and those shared values towards something that there's a greater good that we're trying to do, a public good that we want to work on together. Why don't we together work on some coalition building right here in our area? And we be the leaders in that and say, you know what? There's too much separation. There's too much competition where people are like, no, that's my thing. And I'm not going to share that with you because I need to have a leg up on you. Why don't we say, wait, we could all have a leg up together and do something in a more meaningful way? I could see that. The leaders. I charge myself. I charge President Monaco. Why don't we talk about what we can do as the leaders? Leaders set a tone. Leaders set directions and say, this is important for our institutions to do these things together. And then facilitate how that could happen, how we could actually work across institutions, be it on projects or be it on setting up coalitions or reaching out to policymakers together. We have shared things that we're all reaching for. Why don't we amplify that by doing it in a way that we're coming together collectively, crossing those boundaries, strengthen numbers, strengthen the sharing, and strengthen wanting to make a difference.
Okay, I totally agree. We have an opening here. So our time has whizzed by.
How about that?
But I know that we could continue to have a conversation. So once again, I want to thank you, Professor Barabino. I want everyone to recognize this was a very poignant lecture, personal as well as very useful and applicable for how we want to move throughout society. And I want to thank you basically for leading an excellent and relevant conversation just now. So I think it's been really great. I also would like to thank President Monaco, Dean Q, for allowing me this opportunity to do this lecture today. And to all of you, our audience out there, I know that we have a number of students, we have faculty, there are also staff members. We also have parents, as well as, interestingly enough, people who hire our students, which is great, the employers. So thank you all for being here. And I really enjoy the fact that you all came to this important discussion today. Please be on the lookout for more diversity, equity, and inclusion colloquium in the very near future. For example, I can say that Carl Reed, who is the executive director for the National Society of Black Engineers, will be coming to a Zoom channel on Friday, February 5th, time to be determined. But you also should remember that this session, as well as all previous sessions of the Dean's Lecture, are posted on the Dean's Lecture webpage, which can be found at engineering.tufts.edu/events/Dean's Lecture. Please give us a few days before that gets posted. But I really appreciate everyone's attendance today, but this concludes our event. Please stay safe and enjoy the approaching holiday season in a socially distanced and appropriate manner. Thank you again, Gilda.
I thanks as well.